All right, good evening, everyone. I can please have your attention. Good evening.
Good evening.
What a crowd. Why don't you give yourselves a round of applause? I was literally looking down at my notes right before I said good evening. They had a crazy party in here last night. You should have seen what this place looked like a few hours ago. It was a hot mess. And so I'm looking down, and because the podium's a little dirty, and there's a fortune cookie sitting here. And the front side says, tells you Chinese for be full. But here's what the back side says. And I swear to God, I just picked this up just this minute. Tough times never last, but tough people do. Yeah! I'm going to put that right here and hope some little birdie doesn't come and take it. First up, I want to thank all of you for coming out this evening. There are many people looking for many different things right now. And unfortunately, we're not going to be able to give everything to everyone, but we're certainly going to try to have a productive evening. I personally am playing a couple of different roles. So as a public servant and as a facilitator today. So I'm sure to say something that's going to bother or upset somebody. So in advance, I do apologize. But
I already take offense.
Take a number. One at a time. Let me also thank, I do want to thank our hosts, the Our Revolution crowd who has invited me to facilitate. So just know that, you know, my intentions are good tonight. I want to help facilitate something. But I do need to first be, for just a moment, before I'm your facilitator, be a politician.
Oh.
No.
But we love you.
Love you too. So let's analyze this just a moment from my perspective. The Democratic Party has failed to capture enough of the hearts and minds of the American people to effectively lead. This is possibly the most objective fact we have coming out of Tuesday's election, where tens of millions of people sent a clear message. As a minority myself, targeted by some of the destructive rhetoric used by our president-elect, I can't help but feel vulnerable and worried for myself, my family, and my friends. American Muslims were sent a clear message from a certain faction: you are not part of America. Latinos, immigrants, LGBTQ brothers and sisters, people with disabilities, all were sent a message in different ways that this land was not created equal. Well, today we are here to say we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal, and we will not back down, and we are not going anywhere. Through the numbness, anger, frustration, looking past my own vulnerability, I must critically bifurcate, though, my knee-jerk emotions with the best path forward for our country. I must ask what my country needs from me now. During the civil rights era, there was a classic debate that went on for years between Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. Those of you that lived through that struggle know what I'm talking about. Malcolm believed in change that came through a more direct struggle, where MLK knew in his heart that love and compassion were forces that could slowly erode the darkness in people's hearts. This past election, the establishment Democrats largely fought hate and fear with hate and fear. And we learned Tuesday that MLK's historical voice rings true even today. I don't believe America is divided today as many people characterize it. Rather, I believe we are united in that we the people feel as though we are not heard, and we are struggling to figure out who is going to hear us. We are left confused, and we obviously saw those emotions come through this past Tuesday. So who is listening to us? Today, we begin that long trek of change by amicably trading thoughts and making a plan of action. So that's enough politician. So let's get to work, shall we? We've got a few basic ground rules that we posted in advance. It's also listed on, for those of you that have one, an agenda. Our first rule is there are no silly thoughts. It's only silly when you don't share your thoughts. This is not an anti-Trump gathering, so if you're looking for that, you've come to the wrong place. This is not an anti-Hillary gathering, so you're also in the wrong place. This is not, while we will do a little bit of venting, this is not a venting session. This, however, is a place where we will have respectful dialogue. The meeting is open to all liberals, progressives, left-leaning individuals, those that feel disaffected by what we've experienced. And we will try to build consensus around lessons learned, and we'll use those lessons learned to crowdsource progressive actions for our region. To be fair to everyone, when you're asked to share, if you would be so kind to keep your thoughts concise. And now that we have twice the number of people, please be extra concise with your thoughts. Please know that this is meant to only be a first step in healing and planning and coming together. That not much will be can be forged out of one single meeting. We are creating a process. Process is a sequence of events, but it isn't simply just one event, and that the struggle certainly continues for years to come. So with that, we're going to do, going to take three big, deep breaths. Just relax. Two. And three. Okay. So when you walked in, many of you shared your feelings with us. Many of the feelings are here. I see angry, scared, disappointed, resolute, full of dread. Some people say ready for action, ready to motivate, afraid, angry, disappointed, mad, stunned, tiny, but a bit hopeful. Where is Sumi? Ah, hello. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to ask you the first question, because now is the facilitation part. There's a sequence of things that we're going to go through. Oh, I'm sorry. So the first question that we would like very, very briefly is for if you've got a lesson learned, not a soliloquy, but in a couple of words, a short phrase, lessons learned from this past election, we would love to hear those from you. Simply raise your hand to share your lesson learned. Yes, yes, ma'am.
Don't believe in the polls.
Don't believe in the polls? Yes, ma'am.
Be proactive, not reactive.
Be proactive, not reactive. Yes,
listen,
ma'am, right here.
To everyone.
Listen to everyone. Would you like to?
Me? I can start writing.
Sure. I would write, but my chicken scratch cannot be done. Yes, ma'am, right here.
Don't live in the bubble. Bill Maher always referred to them living in the bubble. It turned out we were the ones in the bubble.
Don't live in the bubble?
Mm-hmm.
Next to her, yes, ma'am.
Politics is persuasion.
Politics is persuasion, yes, sir.
Unfortunately, racism, our original sin, is still alive.
Racism is still alive? Yes, ma'am.
People wanted change.
Yeah. Yes, ma'am, and then sir. Yep.
Oh. Don't have the important conversations on social media.
Be careful with social media. Yes, sir.
The first rule of persuasion is to listen.
Listen. Yeah. Excellent. Yes, ma'am, with the glasses.
Voting is not enough.
Thank you. Thank you. Yes, sir?
Less time tearing down the opponent, more time supporting your candidate.
Less time tearing down the opponent, more time building up your candidate. Yes, sir?
Join.
Join.
Yep.
Organize.
If you're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem.
Right. You're not part of the solution, you're part of the problem. Amen. Yes, ma'am. Don't take your constituency for granted. Thank you. Yes, sir.
Unity is essential.
Unity is essential, especially for us hyper-intelligent liberals, huh? That's a tough one. Yes, yes, ma'am. Teach kindness and respect. Yes, ma'am.
Don't trust the media.
Don't trust?
Don't trust
the media.
Go and do your research.
Thank you. Ma'am, all the way in the back. The media is no longer unbiased. You guys are writing so fast. You guys are great. Thank you.
Empathize.
Empathy.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Elaine.
Sexism and xenophobia are alive and well.
Sexism and xenophobia? Yes, sir.
Be respectful and kind.
Be respectful and kind. Thank you. We have one in the back. Disconnect between the establishment
and the electorate.
And the electorate.
Of all parties.
Yeah.
Of all parties. Yes, sir.
And
then, yep.
The campaign season is too long.
Thank you.
Still wins.
Yes, ma'am.
Look at the pain and fear underneath the divisive rhetoric of hate.
Pay attention to the pain and fear people are having. That is really a big part of the empathy as well. That's great. Yes, ma'am.
And to that I would add, we have to protect our vulnerable.
Protect our vulnerable. Thank you for saying that. Deb.
Thank you. Include all include all groups.
Be inclusive of everyone. Yes, sir.
I hate to say this, but I think again the lesson is learned that negative or attack media sells and sensational action, whatever, also captures the public's attention.
So sensationalism sells?
I think so. It persuades. It captures the news cycle, all of that.
It does. I would argue that it's like a drug, right? I mean,
it
doesn't have a lasting effect. It's that boost. And then what are you left? You're left with this major down afterwards.
I I'd say negative as well. It may not be so sensational, but I'm sorry to say that, but I think it does capture the, much of the larger populace's attention and drives what happens.
Especially when both sides are doing it. I mean, when all sides are doing it and you have no other option, then you're trying to sift through all the negative ads and the sensationalism. It certainly is difficult when there is no other alternative. We do see sometimes there are other alternatives, and I think that the most telling example of a different alternative to the sensationalism that we've experienced and the divisiveness, quite frankly, is our friends to the north with Justin Trudeau.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Justin Trudeau has showed us with a multi-year plan how to build something people can believe in. And unfortunately, we have not offered that on a large scale here in our country, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am?
The need to engage the population that did not vote. Mm-hmm.
The need to engage those that did not vote.
Mm-hmm.
That's half of them.
Some of the large states with lots of electoral college votes that were of people of color, like Mississippi, that went for Trump. How did that happen? What's going on there?
Yeah, so engaging. That's right, engaging the disaffected for sure. Is there a young man right there? Oh, we'd love to hear this one. You're Generation Z.
Yes. To form a more perfect union.
Form a more perfect union. Brian?
Down ballot matters.
Down ballot matters, yeah. For sure. Yes. Yes, ma'am, in the back?
Yes.
When debating, don't answer with how you feel, but ask them how they are feeling or why they think the way they think.
That's really getting at the heart of empathizing with those of different views. I think that's wonderful. We have one right down the middle, way behind. Yes, ma'am. Don't believe it can't happen here. It can happen anywhere. Yes, ma'am.
You can't get to a new place on the same path. There has to be change.
You've got to have change. You've got to have a new path. Well, there's lots of great points here. I believe that we've captured a good chunk. But now is this interactive piece, and believe it or not, we're going to try something crazy with our new big crowd here. But here's where everybody got your stickers? Your green little stickers? So here's what you're going to do. So when you checked in, everybody should have gotten two sets of these. You're only using one set right now. And we have our super large focus group. If you would take your set of two, and in an orderly fashion, we'll move these out of the way. Please come on up and deposit your currency right here. Put your two stickers on what two really you believe are the most important lessons learned of this cycle.
Which third of the room first? So
everybody, come on up.
This is lesson we learned.
All right, looks like we've gotten the placement of our critical new green currency here. Let's take a look. Some of the big winners here are empathy.
Yeah.
Give a round of applause for empathy. They like that. Need to engage people who don't vote.
Yes.
Disenfranchised. People wanted change. Less time tearing down and more time building up. We have over here, listen to everyone. We have voting is not enough. And that's perfectly followed up by join and organize. I know we're not all homogenous here, but I'm a Democrat and I'm going to be organizing and as a Democrat and trying to get good progressives elected, but you've got to organize somehow. And not whoever said the Facebook thing was wonderful. Yes. Not just rant and rave on Facebook, you got to go beyond that, right? Empathize with those different views, so another empathy. Pay attention to pain and fear. Teach kindness and respect. So we had a lot of winners. Many of you, unfortunately, we have about 100 or so copies of these. This document right here. The front side of it is the golden circle plus the human brain. I'm going to talk to that briefly because it touches on the need to engage people correctly, empathizing. We brought it up several different ways, but there's a common thread there. If you don't have it, please look over someone. And for those of you that want these slides in the future, we'll provide them to you. But basically, if you see that, the three concentric circles, do people see that those three concentric circles? Say why, how, what. You see that? Next to that are circles that talk about these two major parts of the brain, the limbic part of your brain and the neocortex. So first let me talk about why, how, what, the golden circle in the human brain. So what is the why? I'm a consultant in organizational development. So what I do is I help facilitate and coach companies through defining this why, how, and what. So the why of an organization, very simple. It's their purpose, the purpose of your organization. The what is pretty simple. It's the product or service or whatever you're offering. We often see a company and we understand their what's very quickly. The how, which is packed in the middle, is a little bit trickier because that is how you conduct yourself. The values of the organization, their core belief, their culture, the individuals that are part, the people that are part of that organization.
Mom, maybe I should stop walking across.
Voice of reason. On the slide below, you see why, how, and what outlined for you. And so what we found is that the what is very easy to understand. And we're going to, Sumi, if we could bring one more over, that'd be great. We're going to actually discuss that a little bit. So the what of an organization is, so tell me the what's of an organization, like Apple. What is the what of Apple? Computers, iPod,
devices.
We can just sit here and go through and very easily figure out. But if Apple sold us a chair, if Apple decided to sell a chair today, would they be successful in selling an Apple chair? They sure would, wouldn't they? But isn't that crazy? It's not their what, it's their how and their why. So as political organizations go, as political movements go, your purpose and your beliefs, your values of an organization, that's what really captures people. And no matter what we're selling, what happens is politicians like me scramble to figure out, I need to get these votes. Let me do some polling and figure out what issues do people care most about. The what issues, right? But the how is completely a huge void right now. So what are the what's of a progressive movement? What are the what's?
Income inequality.
Healthcare.
Education.
Environment.
Social justice.
Jobs.
Big money out of politics.
Immigration reform.
LGBT rights.
Prison abolition.
Protect social security. Ecology.
Jobs.
Okay, so we've got established here the what's of our progressive minds and our progressive movement. We understand we can keep on going down the list. Women's rights. There are so many that we can continue to list. Raising minimum wage, etc. Those are our what's. But let me ask you a more challenging question. Can you define the hows, or what should be the hows of politics, or the hows of this progressive movement?
Corruption.
Identify and groom good leadership.
So the hows, a core belief, could be identify and groom good leadership. We invest in leadership. Investing in leadership is a core belief. Yes, sir?
I have it written down. Everyone who feels left out or left behind has a home with us.
So let's break that into that's wonderful. Let's break that into a how. So what's the how of that? If you had to put it in one word, we said inclusivity. Right, inclusiveness. Perfect.
Identify common goals.
I've got to put that into a how. See, the how is extremely challenging. When I go through...
What I'm saying, how to bring two sides together is why I'm saying that. Identify the common goals, and then people are more likely to listen to the what's.
So, finding common ground. That can be a value. Right. By the way, not everybody has to agree with all these. We're just exploring... What values would we want to see in our political leaders, in our political movements, in leadership in general? Integrity. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Stay
integrity.
On track. Don't get sidetracked. Stay on track.
Focus.
Focus.
Yes, ma'am, in the back.
I've got 3 points, and I'll make it quick. I did volunteer a lot of weekends this fall, and my observation was I love the energy and intelligence of the youth workforce. Experienced older folks being in charge could very well have been more productive. Second, the absence of signage I think was a huge and glaring and horrible mistake, and I was told that decision was made at the heart of the campaign. Third, there seemed to be an obsession with computerized quantification of how many doors you knocked on and all that sort of thing.
So let me turn that into a value. The last part is people over data, right?
Outreach.
That's the impression I have, yes.
So you want to capture it into a value. Yes, sir, right here.
Integrity.
Yeah. Excellent. So a great way I love to identify integrity, where it's very, it speaks to everyone, is always do the right thing. It means something to a lot of different people when we have the right framing. Yes, sir.
Building relationships.
Yes, ma'am.
It's connected with integrity, but accountability.
Accountability?
Yes,
yes, ma'am.
Education. Compassion.
Having compassion and did we say empathize? No, but empathy. That's compassion and empathy together? Okay. Yes, ma'am?
Solidarity.
Solidarity? Yes, sir?
Knowing when to follow rather than when to lead, because a serious problem that I saw was we had lots of latent resources in our community, but certain folks had to be in charge, and that really broke up a lot of our potential to mobilize people.
Know when to be an Indian and know when to be a chief, right? Yes, ma'am. Serious community. Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. Serious commitment. Yes, sir?
Positive message.
Positive message. So always be positive. Yes, ma'am.
Consistency. The message has to be consistent.
Message has to be consistent. Boy, that is so important, right? You know, we communicate in our writings, in our social media, in our mailers, on TV, in person. It needs to be consistent. There's a hand right there. Yes, ma'am.
Educating the uninformed.
Am I missing one? Is there a little? Whoever she's pointing to. I'm sorry, I'm not sure who she was pointing to. I thought I was missing a hand. Katie? Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, bringing the opposing viewpoints together in civil conversation.
So bringing opposing viewpoints together in civil conversation. So there's lots more. Lots of hands, and I'm sorry that I don't get to all of you. We want to keep going through the program, but wonderful ideas on the how. The question is do we see this out of our normal political, either liberal or conservative apparatus?
We did.
So, but we don't consistently see this out of,
we don't.
And I will tell you, you know, this is not to be, we don't want to be political here, but let's be honest. I mean, one of the worst debates I saw was the final Bernie-Hillary debate, where both of them attacked each other. So let's be honest with each other right here. We need to be fair with everyone that, up until the end, we were attacking Donald Trump every which way we could to try to match hate and fear with hate and fear. But, it eroded everywhere across, because once these political consultants get in your ear, all they tell you is you got to bring down their positives and bring up their negatives. And that's political consultants all across the spectrum. And you know what? It took a billionaire to show everybody that something doesn't work in the current system, right?
Yep.
For better or for worse.
What didn't work?
The negative message.
His negative message didn't win.
His negative message didn't win.
Hey, excuse me. Regardless, objectively, the polls were wrong. We didn't perform the way we think that our progressive movement should, right?
Right.
So here we are. The second thing that I will get to, you know now the why, how, what, and you want to think that way, because what we found is when you talk to somebody's what's, when I tell you this is a podium, that's a chair, you're speaking to one part of their brain, the neocortex. The problem is that when you're trying to build trust and loyalty, trust resides in the limbic part of the brain. And so when you're trying to build trust and you're overloading people with a bunch of what's, of why you should fear X, Y, and Z, you're not building the trust that you need to. And what happens is there's just a lack inherently of the trust that people are looking for. So it's very difficult, but only through the execution of these hows, only through the execution of those, are you directly speaking to the limbic part of the brain. The difficulty, though, is it's tough to poll and understand the limbic brain. The reason is because the limbic brain does not have capacity for communication. The limbic brain must communicate with other parts of your brain in order to tell you what it's for you to be able to communicate that out. So it's difficult. Like, I'm standing in front of you and you're going back and forth. Do I trust this guy? Right? I say the same exact thing to all of you, but some of you have a different feeling than others. There's an intuition there. And that intuition is impacted. The trust is impacted in the hows of our progressive movement, in the hows of what we do. The second thing that somebody brought up here, and I appreciated that, was empathy. Several different ways empathy was brought up. Are any of you familiar with E.J. Dionne from the Washington Post? Oh, yes. He's a wonderful columnist. This is what he wrote before the election. Progressives regularly preach empathy. These principles apply as much to the struggles of our political opponents as they do to the problems faced by our allies. Giving an ear and a heart to the legitimate concerns of Trump supporters is the next step for liberals. He's telling us right here, several weeks before the election, we better start listening to everyone, because everyone is important.
But how do you listen to racists and bigots, and how do you listen to those?
You
people?
Have to hear their fear. They're just as
they're
afraid
not
as
all
everyone
like that.
Else.
They are the, I will tell you, if you believe that over 50% of America voted, excuse me, let me say this correctly. You believe that a plurality of voters won the Electoral College for our president-elect and giving them control, and that was all based upon racism, we are sadly mistaken. And while the racism, you are, remember, I wanted to begin with where I'm coming from, me personally, okay? He said, we're going to put up a wall. You ain't coming in here to me and to people like me, right? But I don't believe that this election was because of that racism. Sure, it empowered some of those racists and those xenophobes. Sure, you know, those hateful voices out there who are magnified largely because of the press, they exist. And you're going to see more and more of that. And it's very unfortunate. And it's sad to watch it, even what's happening in our schools. But to blame, to say that that many people were empowered, we are really missing the boat. And we've got to look deep in our hearts and try to figure out how are we going to, and let me tell you the term, is radical empathy. How are we going to be radically empathetic? Let me tell you. So if everybody, thank you for joining us. Everybody already passed up their $100 check.
Use humor.
So let me tell you what is not empathetic. And this is not, you have to take this the right way, but I think everyone cringed when we heard this word, deplorables.
Yes. Yes.
Hillary Clinton, in my opinion, would have been an excellent president. I honestly believe that. I'm just giving you my opinion. These aren't facts up here. It's just my opinion. Would have been an excellent president. I was proud to donate to her. I was proud to work for her. I knew that my Supreme Court, that my meaning our collective Supreme Court, has so our EPA, everything stood on this election. It was way more than one person for me. But that word in and of itself showed me just how disconnected we are sometimes.
Yeah.
And
If I was on the other side, I would have written a piece. And the piece would have been, we are all deplorables. We all have the capacity to hate. We all have those thoughts. You are lying to yourself if you don't think so. They're all sitting in the reptilian part of our brain. But when we enable and engage the prefrontal cortex, the newer parts of our brain, that's what helps us to control the deplorable part of my brain. Because I will tell you, there is a deplorable part of my brain. But I rely on myself, on my faith, on my family, on you all, to make sure that that piece of my brain is always in check. And it takes that training. So now, let me ask you, how are they feeling? How are those Trump voters feeling? How are they feeling? Those voters that were in Wisconsin and in Michigan and in Southwest Virginia, I want you, even on November 7th, how were they feeling?
Hopeful.
Anxious.
Finally empowered.
On the 7th?
They were feeling
the
7th.
The same problem that they were feeling before.
Even before the election.
Left out.
They left out, forgotten, wanted change.
Somebody finally listens and understands us.
Somebody finally, now, by the way, this isn't gospel here. We're trying to empathize here, okay? Somebody finally understands us and gets us. Donald Trump, I may not know what exactly this man is talking about, what he's saying most of the time, but boy, he seems like he's pretty direct with it, right?
We have it on both sides of the aisle.
I think they were feeling a lot of the things we wrote up there, we're feeling now. So they were angry and disaffected.
Angry? Yeah. Disaffected?
Disillusioned, all that stuff.
Yes, ma'am. Disillusioned?
We had it on both sides of the aisle. On their side, there were people that felt disenfranchised, not listened to, not heard. On our side, we had
yep.
the same thing.
Yep.
We come from the same center in our brains. None of us are thrilled like, on either noise. Side with the other party.
I don't want my
the more we get upset, the more...
See my
mom. We feel left out.
We feel left out.
Underpaid.
They felt underpaid. That's a good one. Yes, ma'am, in the back. We were told how to feel. We were told this man is going to destroy our country.
They want to return to safety.
We want to return to safety?
Perceived security.
But the crime statistics are going down. This is a problem.
We're not into that right now. Yes, ma'am?
I don't matter.
Excuse me.
I don't matter.
I don't matter.
Unheard.
Unheard.
Helpless.
Last ditch effort. I mean, this morning, I think the people in McDowell County, on Sunday morning, they interviewed a lot of people. Felt like that. They had hit rock bottom.
It's all the same, so might as well shake the damn thing up, right? Sorry, it's Sunday.
Preach
for me, it's Friday.
Preach it. Preach it.
Yes, ma'am. They felt attacked by the establishment.
Yeah, I think.
So we've explored, and we want to think down and deep, and some of the things that they probably felt are not up here. And I'm not telling you that they're right, but there are feelings, right? We feel much safer as a human race in a homogenous group. But in this country, we are not so homogenous. And in fact, we try to find strength in our diversity. But as that diversity grows, you have naturally people are going to feel more and more threatened. And so they see that. And while as much as we They're not blatantly racist, but they certainly feel uncomfortable that times are changing. And it's not just the color of your skin, but there are two different worlds in this country. And what are those two worlds that were very clear this election more than ever?
Urban
versus rural. Two completely different worlds where Democrats are banking on urban vote and shifting demographics. We have maybe left the rural voters out, right? That's the feeling that they have. So I talk about this radical empathy. And if you'll flip the page over, please. Let me explain to you what most people do not understand about empathy, love, and compassion. So there are, everything that we do exudes two basic things, strength or warmth. What you say, how you dress, words you use, even your posture, exudes either strength or warmth. And we confuse the human race for too long, and to today, we confuse leadership, real leadership, mostly with being just strong. We see those that are compassionate and loving and empathetic as warm. Warm but weak. And so you see on this chart here, we have strength and warmth on the two axes. Those that are very strong but not very warm, some may argue that our president-elect, for example, is exudes those attributes, lead mainly with fear and envy and a whole variety of other attributes. But it works sometimes because at least you know, or that person has got you scared enough to not vote for the other side. There are some people, and you can picture some of them in your mind, who exist in society or your friends or people around you that are super warm. And those people that try to then be leaders are viewed with kind of a certain sense of pity. When I was elected, a gentleman called me up and he warned me that I was using a couple, he's a friend, to this day he's my friend. He warned me I was using a couple of words too frequently and it showed too much warmth all the time. And so what's not on this axis is the third piece, which is time. There's a time for strength and a time for warmth. And so you've got an X and Y axis here. If there was a Z axis, you'd also want to discuss time, right? When you're first getting to know someone, you certainly probably want to have a little bit more warmth so they can learn to trust you. But those leaders that are truly admired over time, they found a balance. And what does it say for those leaders who had warmth, high degrees of warmth, and high degrees of strength?
Admiration.
Admiration. Those are the leaders that we admired. Let me ask you, when you think of John F. Kennedy, do you see him as weak?
No.
Do you think that he was a warm person?
Yes.
Do you also see him as a strong leader?
Yes.
Those of you that are maybe once upon a time on the other side of the aisle, Ronald Reagan, was Ronald Reagan viewed as weak?
No.
Was Ronald Reagan, was he viewed as warm?
Yes.
Yeah. Was, hey, we're not, Bill Clinton?
Yeah.
Was both strong and warm. But I'm not, we're not endorsing anybody's policies here. And I certainly believe the hero of my time, whether you like him or not, that Barack Obama. Yeah. And I'm sorry to throw politics in the middle of this and pull some of the objectivity. But I am, I'm sorry.
Shameless.
But I believe that he, more than anybody, of course, in my short lifetime, has taught me that, has taught me the balance of strength and warmth. So don't let anybody tell you that you shouldn't be empathizing with other people on the other side. Don't let people will say, I read one thing this morning saying, you should save your empathy for the people that he, President-elect, that he's going to hurt. Hello? Maybe they're already at work here. That he's going to hurt. But boy, we are really missing the boat. We are all brothers and sisters of the human race. And I can be strong in my advocacy. I can be strong in believing in the issues that are important to me, like raising minimum wage and getting big money out of politics. I can talk about all these different things. But at the same time, I can love you with every fiber of my being. And I am unapologetic about that. And that's the kind of leadership we need. And we will call that radical empathy. There's a sad story that I'm going to tell you that Stephen and several others of you will recall this, but I think it's important to share this story very briefly with you. We were at the Veterans Day Parade about a week ago.
Yes.
What happened at the Veterans Day Parade before we had our kickoff, before we stepped off?
The truck wouldn't start.
We had the Democratic crowd, and we had this little truck with us, and a gentleman was kind enough to let us use it. We appreciate that. And the truck wouldn't start. We were about to kick off, and the truck wouldn't start. I went to the SUV next to us, and this SUV, ironically, it was carrying a Native American. It was like some woman who won some Native American pageant here in Appalachia. I'm sorry, I don't remember the context, and no disrespect intended, but she was a woman who, but he had his paving company on the front of it. And then she's in the back. And I thought that was pretty neat that she was here. I'd never heard of that. And I said, hey, excuse me, sir. Looks like her battery's gone dead. Would you mind giving us a jump? And he said, where? I said, right there. He said, you mean that truck with all those signs on it? I said, yes. There's a Native American man next to this gentleman. He said, the Native American man, that he kind of told the guy, it doesn't matter. You need to stand up for what you believe in. And that guy looked me square in the face, Stephen, and he said, I was kind of hoping that truck would go down. And I was waiting for him to crack a smile, but he did not. And I told him, thank you and have a nice day. But I'll tell you what I really wanted to do. What I really, really wanted to do was to, time was of the essence because we were about to step off. The parade was about to get going. What I really, really wanted to do was, because this man, doesn't matter, but he didn't know who I was. But I wanted to go back into the car, into my car, which wasn't there, but and grab my cards. And I wanted to give him my card and everybody in his car and say, if there's ever anything that I can do for you, I'm a public servant and I'm at your service anytime. The reason why I discuss that story and why I discuss radical empathy with you is because radical empathy is highly counterintuitive. Our emotions take us in a completely different direction. And so your challenge, as you think about their feelings, as you think about that direction that people believe that our country is headed, you've got to dig deep, and you've got to put your emotions aside, and you've got to figure out how can we really be part of the solution moving forward. So with that, I actually want to ask your opinion, and we have another writing moment, if you could help us, Monica. We're going to use these ideas now, because you're going to be voting on these ideas one more time. We only do one more vote, cash in your currency. But here's where we organize. We want to hear your ideas, your constructive ideas on how we can best move forward. And let me just tell you what's going to happen here. Just like we did before, we're going to shift these over here momentarily. We're going to take your ideas, we're going to put them up here, and then people are going to use their currency to then figure out what ideas. Hello. They're going to figure out what ideas they like the best. And then we're going to organize around the top ideas that you all discussed, and you'll be able to organize in different groups around that. That'll be the second half of what we do. So constructive ideas. Yes, ma'am.
We have groups in Roanoke like the NAACP and the ACLU that are already doing progressive work. We need to support those groups that are already here, not just form a new group that takes the strength away.
So supporting existing groups. Yes, ma'am?
This is kind of a wacky idea, but I believe one of the problems in Congress is there is very little overlap anymore. They used to count the most liberal Republican and the most conservative Democrat and see where they all fell. In the 80s, there were 344 people who fell between that, and I'm trying to quote a pollster. Do you know how many people today fall in that category of Congress? 4. And that's why I believe we've gotten anything done. So my thought process for moving forward is, how do you put centrist? So we are back in Congress.
So the answer to that is, one answer to that is fix gerrymandering. So work on redistricting reform. Good idea. And there are groups around that. Yes, ma'am, and then back here.
We need to put party leadership in place and candidates in place that can help move the party forward progressively.
Mm-hmm. New progressive leadership, which means joining and organizing, right? That's right. Yes, ma'am.
Lynchburg here.
Yeah.
There's a special election coming up where they can flip. They can flip the Virginia Senate to Democrat, and they figured out a way to do it, and they need people to help. They need people to knock on doors and phone bank. And
okay.
They have a caucus and figure out who's going to run by Tuesday.
We'll put that in the organized column. She's just referring to, for those of you who don't know, Senator Garrett is now Congressman Garrett, and his Senate seat will be a special election here soon. Yes, ma'am?
We talked about empathy and listening, so I have no idea how this would work, but listening groups, where one side, we sit and practice listening.
Listening groups, and I know that Katie Zawacki's jumping out of her chair because she has listening groups.
Nonprofit locally for the last 2 years, and we are sponsoring discussion groups called study circles. They've had a long history in this country of dialogue between people of different views, and we're forming study circles right now, and really, really would like
so
to.
So discussion groups. Thank you, Katie. Yes, ma'am?
I'm going to own it. I'm really struggling with this call for empathy. I'm struggling with the call for empathy right now. Because what I think needs to happen moving forward is a lot more speaking out. I have heard so many words in the last week that when I was growing up, I would have had my mouth washed out for using.
Yep.
So where is the speaking out against that?
So making sure that there's an adequate platform to speak out. Yes, sir? Yes? Whoever, I'm sorry. I apologize. Oh,
yeah, like her, I'm having a bit of a time with this empathy concept. Like, I've been either Democrat Republican, and then Republican, Conservative, at least for me, I get insulted by both sides, being who I am. So I'm just, I can't. I'm having a bit of a problem right now.
Okay, please, constructive ideas on how to move forward. Yes, sir?
Train of thought. We need to persuade occasional voters to vote in every election.
So persuading voter engagement, and it's the whole chicken and egg. Do you got to give them something to vote for first, or do they vote first? And I think we've all struggled. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
So let's put inform and persuade voter engagement.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, ma'am. Yes.
Echoing what I said, what this gentleman said earlier, it would be wonderful if people coordinating the campaign would listen to the people in the small communities and on the ground. And I didn't get the sense that.
So ensuring that. Ensuring that our the party establishment hears people locally. Yes, ma'am.
A couple of things. First, a lot of the suggestions that are coming are like within the system. This system is what's broken, so keep doing what y'all are doing with getting progressives into the system. But we need to, as mostly white people here, we need to listen to organizations that are led by people of color, like Black Lives Matter. And one of my suggestions in making actual, tangible progress as a white person is cop watching. And I do believe, I just relocated here from Nashville. I was born and raised here, but if people are already doing this, I would love to hear about it. It is a tangible thing. If you watch the police, they're less likely to abuse their power. And with someone like Donald Trump as president, the Fraternal Order of Police endorsed him, the KKK endorsed him. We are looking at more police violence in the future. So cop watching, just civilly watching, recording.
So cop watching?
Cop watching and then downloading apps such as Cell 411.
Well, save that because we're going to, you all will have a chance to discuss in groups here shortly. Yes, ma'am, with the glasses.
I think we need to radically change the role of our local Democratic committees. We need to be building grassroots infrastructure. These shouldn't just be fundraising apparatuses that engage once every 4 years.
Yes. Radically yes. Change the Democratic committee apparatus, and I will tell you that the Democratic committee people in the room, and there are several different groups here, they would love for you to radically come and change them. Yeah. I'm serious. Yeah. They are ready for you to join and help lead. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
To
develop a local platform.
Right.
Yes, ma'am?
I think they can go on the nonviolent communication process, especially in the public school system.
Yes.
Educate people on nonviolent communication process, like restorative justice in school, etc.
Particularly.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
As a group, as progressives, how about we start reaching out to people to run for some of these local offices and to run for the House of Delegates? We really need to find progressive candidates to run for these offices. Recruit and find progressive candidates to take these offices.
Yes. Will?
I don't really know where this would fall into all this, but you know, we have to be mindful, and actually I heard on NPR a couple of weeks ago a lady talking about judging ourselves with the same voice we judge other people. And the language we use, we need to think about that stuff, because the last couple of, I've seen people tossing around that article, or the photos of Melania when she was posing nude, and when we, you know, try to, they call it slut-shaming. We need to be mindful of the language we use, too, for other people, just because we're angry or we're upset.
Mindfulness in particular, excellent. Yes, whichever one of you wants to go first, but.
I think that we need to, within our groups, we also need to understand the relationship with support in organizations like the UN and internationally, because I think we have a number of issues that our president-elect may work through the system that exists, that the American people may not have the ability to actually do something, but on an international level, we need to know who our allies are and understand that process of communicating with them very clearly, especially the UN.
So understanding, that's really understanding international relations, encapsulating that. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
More locally, join and support the Rural Caucus, which is fairly young and needs our help.
Join and support the Rural Caucus.
Where you get to learn about rural areas.
I represent Roanoke City in the Virginia House of Delegates, and I'm a member, purposefully, of the Rural Caucus, Legislative Rural Caucus. I'm one of the only or few Democrats that are part of that. And they even adopted me in the Legislative Black Caucus. So we get to be in all of the above. Yes, ma'am.
My background in retail advertising is going to show, I think we need the groups and we need the information sessions, but what we also need is personal information. You know, way back when the campaign started, you got postcards in the mail saying, vote for this person. If we have a record of this person or this address, send them a card, say, hey, we're having a coffee. We're going to discuss Social Security. What is the impact on you? Or if you're at a college, a sign-up sheet, or better still, hey, I'm going to go to this discussion on student loans. Would you like to come with me? Personal invitation. You know, it's going to be at 2 o'clock, and remind them, and then go and get them.
So that's a lot more of education on issues?
But education, not only education, personal contact.
Engage.
Make
retail.
It like, you please
retail
come
politics
with me.
With personal, retail yeah. politics, personal education on issues? Yes, ma'am?
Me?
Yep.
I think we need action plans to combat the attacks we know are coming on vulnerable areas, including the environment, the LGBTQ community, women's reproductive health, and immigrants.
I think we need to engage young people. I'm 21, and I know what young people were not engaged in this past election. And I think one way we can do that, I helped start an organization called Your Vote, Your Voice. I would really encourage all of you to go online and Facebook and like the page Your Vote, Your Voice. I think we need to get more people, as this young lady said earlier, registered and involved. Voting is just the beginning, but a lot of young people aren't voting, don't know what's going on. And I'm telling you, if they did, we would have won this election.
Get more young people involved. That's a great one. Yes. Sir, up here, who had his hand
up. Oh, hi.
Hey, how you doing?
I'm great. How are you?
I'm great.
I just wanted to make a point on the vulnerable parties that we were speaking out about. Not sure. I know some of you. I don't know all of you. I worked on the Hillary Clinton campaign, and something that I am worried about now is that under a Trump administration, these parties or these subcategories of people are going to be more affected, and you know, the LGBT community and the Black community and minorities in general. So a few of my friends and I, Richmond and Roanoke, other regional areas, are starting a coalition that's going to increase awareness on groups like the NAACP and the Diversity Center as well. So it's going to be basically a large database, and there will be more information for that. If you get involved with the Roanoke City Democratic Committee and other organizations like that, we'll have more information.
Okay. Thank you. I think we'll take just a couple more, and then we're going to transition. Yes, ma'am?
I feel like that we need to help people move from grieving to empathy. You talk about radical empathy. I think that's wonderful. I'm having a lot of difficulty separating my feelings about this man who I feel has spouted hateful, dangerous things, to understanding and empathizing people who voted for him and why. And I think that maybe some of us are stuck in that grieving and angry process, and we need to help people move from one to the other, because we can't do radical empathy if we're so upset ourselves.
We need to transition and find ways of transitioning out of the grieving process. Let me just mention that it is so important to go through your grieving process. It really is. I mean, I've never, maybe I'm showing my warmth, but my naivete. I mean, at 2:30 in the morning, when they said the words Hillary Clinton called to concede the election, I've never felt numb like that before. I didn't know what I was feeling. I don't know. And so it is perfectly normal. Empathize with yourself first, right?
Yeah.
That's okay. No, there's nothing wrong with that. So making sure we have ways of grieving and getting through that process, because obviously there were a lot of emotions going through this 2-year campaign, and we can't just pretend like none of that happened. And I think that's a very, very important point. Yes, ma'am.
To step up and support those who are vulnerable, but in non-violent ways, which are very effective if there are many people doing it correctly.
So learning about non-violent training, non-violent resistance, and there are a couple of things, a couple of people, a couple of organizations that are doing that work. I know that there are lots more hands up. We have to move on. I'm sorry. But now you get to get up. And this is, you get to get up and do one thing before we're going to do actually two things together. You come up and vote on where you want to put your currency, and then we're going to split up into some groups based upon the top ones, and I'll explain that to you after we vote. And at the same time, if there's anybody that wants to grab one of those, a slice from the 24 pizzas in the back, you can go and grab a slice of pizza. So come on up and use your... Have a seat. So many people have come up to me and shared a lot of thoughts. Many people are excited we're having this meeting, and there are lots of pent-up frustrations about a variety of things that, unfortunately, one meeting, one gathering, one group, nothing's going to address all of them. There are elephants in the room about we are not trying to look past what the terrible rhetoric that has been used by our president-elect, but we're trying to figure out how to have a constructive conversation. We're also not, there are difficult conversations and reconciliation that even needs to happen between our supporters of our Democratic candidates during the primary process. And we know that those feelings are still there for many people. Hillary people wondering, where did the Bernie folks go sometimes? Bernie people saying, feeling that they weren't heard. We've heard lots of lots of these things. These are all very valid. No one is telling you not to protest. We were just saying that tonight is not the protest. And no one's telling you you shouldn't have these feelings about one person or another. But tonight was to focus on moving forward and how we are going to come together. And we know that 3 hours of being together, especially 3 hours of being with the politician at the front of the room, but that's not going to solve anything. But what we're trying to do is we learned from Justin Trudeau in a multi-year process that you've got to begin a conversation somewhere. And these are difficult conversations. And I promised you at the beginning of this that I was going to leave out something or say something that some people may not like. So I tried to apologize for that ahead of time. I know it's difficult to talk about empathy when it's obvious that certain factions do not want to be empathetic. But let me tell you, there are two victories at the end of this road. Very clearly. One victory has us with, I don't know, maybe a Republican-led administration that takes us down wrong paths, and people realizing that all of the what's they had banked on didn't come true. And we're able to piece together a coalition again to win the presidency, to win more elections. Now, that's one victory. But the question is, how long will that victory last? The second victory might take a tiny bit longer, but it's a more lasting victory of not piecing together coalitions, but of trying to move enough hearts and minds to move this country forward permanently instead of the zero-sum game that we've been playing for too long. So I understand some of what I had to say about empathy, about coming together, is difficult. And I do not expect all of you to agree with me. That is not the point. But those of you who brought up empathy, I wanted to tell you what radical empathy is about. Some of you brought up civility. Why, how, what is a paradigm to think through when thinking through the politics of civility. So we need to take those ideas and critically think through them, not agree with all of them, but take what we think works and dive deeper together so we can take action together as Americans. Because, you know, in my first campaign, I didn't have children. Now I have three of them. And so I used to say in my first campaign, this is about the future and this is about the kids. I didn't even know what that meant. Now I look at them and my daughter's about to turn 7 and 6. I have two daughters. 7 and 6. And there was a part of me, you know, that was so ready to be able to tell my daughter that a woman became president. Regardless of how you feel about that woman. But there was a part of me that wanted to move this country forward, you know, in that direction. It really is about the future. It really is about my future, about our future moving forward. So be thinking through that, how we're going to come together and organize. It took me years to get into public service. And it's going to take us years to pull us out of this rut that we're in right now. What we do know is what we've done in the past is not going to work in the future. So we better figure something out. And that's why we're here together. I love you guys, even those of you that maybe don't like me sometimes. We have 6 groups that we're going to organize around. And let me tell you, just so you know what's going to happen at the end of the organization, each group is going to report back. But then there are lots of organizations here, and I promise those organizations, you're going to have a name your organization piece at the very end, because we want people to know what organizations are already in the group, because One of these, which was a surprise to me, which I'm glad to hear it, was that you all voted for, was support existing organizations, which is wonderful. And so I'm going to name to you the six that you voted on, and then we're going to organize. That's why we've got two tables here, two in the middle on either side, and then there are two in the back on either side, because you're going to organize into the six top vote-getters, and we're going to have a discussion here for the next 20 minutes or so. So the top six were, and then I'm going to encourage you to get up and kind of go to where you would like to be, is number one is action plan on vulnerable issues is right here. So you're going to be organizing right here. Who would like to be a group leader on action plan for vulnerable issues? All of you. Okay. We got several people. Okay, great. I just need to make sure that there's at least one person that's interested. There are a few of them right here. Thank you very much, all three of you, so we can lead this. We've got supporting, number two over there, supporting existing groups. Would someone like to help lead the conversation on supporting existing? We've got a hand right there in the back. Thank you, Robin. Supporting existing groups. On the back, and this was one of the top vote getters, is gerrymandering, and there are several issues related to gerrymandering, but it's really a lot of election reform. But gerrymandering in particular is in the back corner. Someone would like to help lead us in gerrymandering? In the gerrymandering conversation? Not in gerrymandering, but we don't need any help with that. Who would like to help lead us in that conversation? We've got one back there. Thank you so much. Listening to minority voices is right here. Who would like to help with this conversation? Listening to minority voices. Bill, thank you so much. Thank you. We'll glad to have a couple of people. Number two is recruit and train progressive candidates.
A progressive candidate.
And then learn about nonviolent training is the back corner. Yes,
Angela.
We've got one.
Angela,
thank you so much. Okay, excellent. So if now we can get up one more time, and you can, by the way, we're at the point where you can arrange all the chairs any which way you want to be comfortable, and then we're going to meet back here in about 20 minutes. All right. I know we've got a lot of new friends. So we've had lots of questions about next steps, and people have even asked the question, when's the next time we are meeting? We're going to be sharing some of your thoughts here briefly, but I just wanted to mention that the point of this meeting wasn't for there to be one big group meeting in perpetuity. And to listen to Sam do that all the time. I mean, we actually, of course, know that there are lots of existing groups, lots of people with lots of energy that have built up some wonderful things, and we want to be able to empower them. One thought that I did want to share with you, because I know a lot of people have talked about the negative emotions, the way we still are grieving and are torn. And, you know, growing up, I didn't get sick a lot.
Lucky.
I know, we're lucky. I didn't really get sick a lot, maybe because I love drinking my orange juice. And then this magical thing happened. I was so blessed to have three beautiful children. And my beautiful children bring home their beautiful germs every day.
Oh, yeah.
And so, without fail, every year we pass things around. Many of you know that. Because I'm just, in this cesspool of germs. We take a little bit of a break in the summer, but we kick it off every fall. That's how disease works, right? The germs are just around it more often. Before the information age, we communicated, and then we went home, and we were with our family, and we were in our churches, and we were at our work. But the information age has changed something. And there are these germs, these mental germs that we are constantly bombarded by. And it's mostly through social media, right? Social media has done wonderful things for us. But I can't pull up my feed right now without being bombarded by those mental germs. And that has a psychological impact on you. That's why it's so difficult for us to empathize sometimes, especially with people that are radically different than us. So I just want you to know, in my humble opinion, why it can just be so difficult today, even than the way it was just a few years back, so difficult for us to turn the switch off. And why we feel as though we are such a divided nation, right? We have that feeling. But in fact, you just need to know that what it takes one of my kids to make us all sick. It takes one person in my feed to plant that mental germ. And is Jack still here? Jack, so my wonderful worker back there, Jack, turned me on to this video. It's a 5-minute video that went through and kind of explained it, the neuroscience behind that. So it's important to be self-aware as to why some of what we're saying can be difficult. But that's part of the challenge in trying to overcome it. Of course, without social media, I would not have been elected. But certainly with social media, it makes some of our challenges even that much more difficult. So with that, we're going to... we're just going to go around to each group and give us your top action item that you all came up with, that you really enjoyed, just so people can hear some of the wonderful thoughts that came out of. Let's start with action plan on vulnerable issues.
So we came up with a list of the issues that we thought were going to be most likely endangered in the next few months and years, and then individuals selected the issues that they wanted to follow and then commit to send forward to the group. We exchanged our emails and we'll try to meet again the first week of December and try to build on the infrastructure that's already present in the Valley to know where we are now and prepare for whatever's coming down the pike. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing, and we'll we're going to take these emails. Our revolution will have a set. I'll have a set. We're going to create a group list so that way you'll be able to be in touch with one another. But like we said, this is not, unless you guys continue to demand it, not something that is supposed to be us in a big group in perpetuity. But you can contact me. If you have some other thoughts, Brian?
So, supporting our existing group.
He's that lovable.
so we came up with fairly substantial list of only some of the groups that exist in the valley, in the city and the immediate valley. And we identified a couple problems, maybe a lack of coordination between groups, maybe and a lack of communication between groups and their members, and potential redundancies. And we identified a potential solution as coordinating an individual progressive email calendar, or not calendar, but newsletter, that would go out, that would identify individual events that, you know, one-line summaries with additional information and links out. Plus, some of the deeper stuff we got into is maybe doing a quarterly call with these groups, having an organized activist calendar, which sounds like that's already kind of being worked on, and using our existing structures as organizing hubs, as opposed to going out and creating new ones.
Thank you, Ryan.
Because we talked about that in our group as well. Chris Fury and had a conversation with Ben, and Ben signed up to create a website with the calendar. It's called RoanokeCalendar.org. There's nothing on it for November, but he did try to keep up with events prior to that. And I think we could have an organizational meeting to see how we can actually sort of support of someone taking that position and really, you know, or several people being administrators and keeping up with it, whatever needs to happen.
So this is Ben. Raise your hand, Ben.
Hi.
All right.
Hey, Ben.
So the site's there. So, it's all ready to go. Just need people to just put events on a Google Calendar, and it'll show up on there. It's easy.
So you guys can connect.
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
All right. So our issue with gerrymandering, and for those of you, just to clarify, is when boundaries are drawn to favor one party or ethnic group, disadvantage those. And so It's an issue that would have to be affected at the Virginia Constitution, or Virginia Constitution. So basically, you just need to join onevirginia2020.org. This is 2021.org. They are handling this whole movement, and they've got ways you can contact your delegates and state senators, but that's the main action.
And you guys are hosting a movie? Did I just volunteer you for that?
Yeah. Yeah, they put together, we might have it.
All right. Thank you.
One Virginia 2021.
Yeah. Listen to minority voices.
The four things that we thought should be focused on was open dialogue with different groups. Address voter suppression, including IDs and closed precincts. Stop redlining, and that includes socially among ourselves, governmentally, and politically. Quit redlining various groups and thinking that they can stay over there, we can stay over here. And outreach to underserved groups, and also to support minority media.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We need to get a lot written down.
Yeah, no, we did a lot of talking.
So one of the things that we found fundamentally helpful in...
which is support and train progressive candidates, right?
So join your local Democratic committee, please.
Yes.
Get involved so that you can meet with people who are politically inclined in the same manner that you are. You know, I shared with our group some progressive values that I hold, and really, you know, that can change geographic region, from geographic region to, you know, person to person. So what you have to do is figure out a way to get with people that are on the same ideological spectrum as you. Join the committees, find these people, talk to the people who are already politically involved, become a candidate.
Or support one.
Or be a support staff for somebody. You don't even have to be, like any of you right now, I know you have Sam over here, but you can support me.
Supporting him?
Yeah.
Was it William? Where's?
Virginia Beach.
Is
21st District.
21st District.
Yeah, we're working on his disability policy, what he's doing.
Yeah, so.
Well, thank you. No, that's perfect. And I'm going to make a shameless plug that I was my little idea that I shared with them. So we're trying to start an initiative called Consent of the Governed. And this is a training for, we're going to start in our area, a training initiative for people in our region. Number one, you take a pledge. The pledge is mostly around the hows that we talked about. Number two, you go through training. And then number three, you receive free consulting in public relations and communications. So that way you've got somebody actually helping you every step of the way. This is for progressives.
Yeah.
This is for people who want to not only run for office, but want to lead progressive organizations. So that may be a progressive nonprofit or whatever it may be.
Which is a document which will help you to determine the people who share the same ideological ideas that you have, right? So it's, we need to stand together and we need to join together and we need to work within the structures that are in place to get our ideas out there. And then we need to get out and vote when these elections come up. In Virginia, we have an election every year.
I'll give you a handout. Consent of the Governed. Yeah, this is an idea that I just actually hammered out this week because something else happened this
website?
Week.
Is it on your website?
Oh, I need your help in fine-tuning it. I haven't put it on the website yet, but I'll give you a handout, and then you can give me some of your feedback on it. You'll certainly be hearing more about it. But anybody that wants more information on training that can happen right here in our area, please come grab one of these. Make sure you grab one of my cards. And let's have a conversation about how that can happen here for candidates in our region. It can be for anybody in Virginia, but we'll certainly try to get it going here in our region. Yes, who's our leader in the back? All right.
So we talked about the four parts of the NDC process, which is observation, feeling, needs, and requests. We're going to meet with a NDC trainer so that we can all get a little bit more knowledgeable and proficient at communicating NDC style. And so we can protest nonviolently and then spread the nonviolent communication process to the world.
So we'd like to take a moment and maybe Katie, were you in that group? No, you weren't in that group? You were in this group. Okay. I was going to start with you. I thought you were in that group because you guys do. I mean, you've got the wonderful group. But right now, we'd like to make sure everybody knows what organizations are in the room. So this is a small segment. We'd like to call name your organization. So very briefly, you're just going to stand up, name your organization, what your name is, how to get in touch with you, and maybe when you meet or something like that. No long soliloquy, but we want to make sure there are lots of great organizations in here. I want to make sure people know who to contact should they have a question. So, Katie, do you want to lead us off?
Katie Swagby, and I'm the chair of the advisory board for Points of Diversity. Our mission is promoting inclusion in the Roanoke Valley. That means inclusion of all people, regardless of sexual identity, color, and including party. So include everybody. And we have our second annual membership meeting next Sunday from 2 to 4 at Grandin Court Baptist Church. A little outline of what we've done in the past year. And we've got several young people going to speak about why it's important for them to be included in their school community. So if you want to learn and find out more, just come next Sunday.
Thank you. Thank you, Katie. And if I know it's a lot to remember, but most of these folks are my friends, so make sure you can talk to them. If you forget, you can grab my card, and I will be happy to connect you, connect all of you. Or other organizations, just raise your hand, and we'll call on you. Yes, ma'am?
Hi, my name is Megan Duvall, and I represent the Roanoke Sierra Club. So if your heart bleeds green and everything is your issue, find us on Facebook, Roanoke Sierra Club. Sierra Club is the nation's oldest and largest grassroots environmental organization. We're going to look at some civil disobedience training as well.
Thank you, Megan. Roanoke Sierra Club. David?
David Denham with Represent Roanoke Valley, and we're all about getting big money out of politics. I don't know if you know the good news of Tuesday, but 8 states passed ballot initiatives around anti-corruption legislation. 600,000 Represent Us volunteers, cross-partisan, made that happen. So we are fortunate through shepherding a Bill Best pitch last year to have a resolution passed by the City Council. Now we want to do it with Salem, Vinton, and Roanoke County Supervisors. The challenge is this is truly a cross-partisan effort. And so we need help. So we not only want you to come, but we want you to bring your Republican friend with you. And to help us walk through that process, we're hiring a high-powered consultant at our next meeting, Sam.
Hiring is the corruption piece right there. I am working for free. Is Angela still here? No cookies. Is Angela still here?
Angela.
Yeah, Angela helped to start it, and I just wanted to recognize her because she worked very hard for a couple of years, so which is fantastic. She said she wouldn't break my neck if I didn't sign the anti-corruption. But the reason why I'm glad she convinced me to. But you know, the corruption piece, why it's particularly bipartisan, is because it's not a what issue. It's a how thing, right?
Exactly.
Kind of like the gerrymandering. So that it gets really deep. I'm sorry, there were lots of hands right here and then right there.
So I just want to recognize...
Please stand if you don't mind.
I want to recognize Ben for starting... He started Compact Cinema at 16 West, and his show films like Inequality for All and what are some of the other ones?
Pay to Play and
Freedom Riders. And when Ian Poirier took the position at the Grand Inn Theater, he came down and he sort of watched Ben and observed and was able to pick that up. I think he already had that interest and picked it up and brought that into the Grand Inn Theater. That's been sort of integrated in, and so with groups that are already in existence, I would definitely encourage you to reach out to Ian Poirier at the Grand Inn Theater because they do host movies there, and they also bring people on as panelists to have discussions.
So at least once a month, Grand Inn Theater will host some of these movies for sure. Yes, ma'am.
As a representative of Montgomery County Democrats, we're holding a vigil tomorrow evening from 5:30 to 7 on the Henderson Lawn to express our deep values of inclusion, fairness, and American dream of equality, and all are welcome.
Thank you, and so Montgomery County, Blacksburg, Christiansburg.
Henderson Lawn.
You know who to contact. Yes, yes.
I'm just a general member of both, but we have the Roanoke Diversity Center, which is the local LGBTQ center on Jefferson Avenue. And that has events all the time. They have a Facebook, they have a major website that you can check everything out. And also Black Lives Matter Roanoke, which usually meets in Melrose Park on Saturdays at 6, but due to the weather, we're probably gonna have to, we're picking out a new location of it.
Black Lives Matter and Roanoke Diversity Center, which has a physical location at the Metropolitan Community Church in Southeast Roanoke. Yes, ma'am.
In contact with our greater community members and exchange services. So we promote a currency of time and helping instead of money. You can go to rvte.org or go to Roanoke Valley Time Exchange.
Roanoke Valley Time Exchange. Someone will wash your windows, you fix their plumbing, whatever it may be. That's a different way of trading currency. Stephen?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Stephen Yanisha. I'm the chair of the Roanoke City Democratic Committee. We want you to come join us, whether you're a Democrat or not. We want you to come join us. We want to be part of the political revolution that's happening. That means inviting everybody to the table, okay? That means reaching across the aisle. In fact, I'll tell you just briefly. The other thing that happened before the parade on last Saturday is this guy came up to us and he asked if he could put all this Trump stuff all over his truck, and he was trying to challenge us. And rather than kind of challenging him back, I extended my hand and said, "Hello, my fellow American." Because I wanted to focus on what we had in common, not what was different between us. And that's the spirit of what the Roanoke City Democratic Committee is about. We're trying to bring people together. We're trying to encourage people to vote. You voted today. You voted last Tuesday. Thank you for your vote. Come out on Thursday at 6 and vote again by getting involved with our organization.
Thank you, Stephen. Eddie.
Hey, my name's Eddie C., and I'm with Your Vote, Your Voice. You know, we're all about getting people registered to vote. We're all about getting voter restoration rights restored. But we're more than just about voting rights and voter suppression. We're also about focus groups with millennials, religion and public policy, LGBT issues. And so we feel like we're offering some really good discussions for the community to learn and to open themselves up. So we have next Tuesday night a debriefing session, and if you guys will look us up on Facebook at Your Vote, Your Voice, we'll be glad to share some of that with you. But Andrew's here with me tonight, Andrew Todd from Ferrum College, and it's really a great opportunity to be together with you guys tonight. Also represent Democracy Spring. And I hope that you guys will come out and support Democracy Spring when you can. It's pretty a nonpartisan movement, all about corruption and getting money out of politics, but at the same time, restoring those rights to people that are on the fringes and are certainly not getting the attention that they need to get. Thank you so much for being here tonight. Really, really appreciate it. All that you guys do in this community and helping us be what we need to be.
Thank you, Eddie. Thanks for all of you. I want to just briefly recognize Monica and Chris from our revolution. Many of you know them, but they're also helping to subsidize the pizza and water, etc. If you would like to make a monetary donation, I'm making a donation. They would certainly appreciate your support for helping to have this. And also, Sunny Shaw let us have this space for free. He's not here, but he's the owner here. He's always helped all the Democrats, so thank you so much. Yes, Josh.
Yeah, my name is Josh Daniel. Director of
Fresno
House PA, and we drove several hours here with Tom.
4 hours.
Yeah.
4 hours. Give it a round of applause.
And you know, there are myths in our part of Virginia as well as the North that in this part of Virginia, right, it's very red. Well, apparently it's not the case, right? I mean, I assume all you guys vote, but yeah, this is really hurting.
We're not seeing what blue.
I don't know if you all understand, but the legislative body in which Sam serves is unbelievably undemocratic when you look at the way in which these delegates are selected. And if you look at the data from 2015, 71 out of 100 of these delegates ran unopposed. No incumbents lost. Right? So imagine if 71 out of 100 people don't even have competition. That means there are, in almost all of those cases, Republicans running against no one on the left. So if you are a Democrat who lives in these districts, there is no point in coming out to vote because you're going to vote, right? Our goal as a PAC is to make sure there are progressive candidates in every single House of Delegates race in 2017. And at the moment, I believe we have 9 candidates who have filed. We have more coming down the pipeline next week. These are not like crackpot fringe lunatics. These are very serious individuals who you can read about on our Facebook.
Put that on your literature. Make sure if you want to learn more about Progressive House, make sure you Facebook search Progressive House, contact Josh.
ProgressiveHouseVA.com. We will be back in this region in a much more demanding way very soon. But this is our first real trip out here, and it's been fantastic.
Thanks to both of you for making the trip. We really appreciate it.
My name is Tina Badger, and I actually work with Preserve Montgomery County, Virginia. We're one of the groups that are fighting the Mountain Valley Pipeline. Yeah. Yeah. We actually have a coalition with several of the groups for Franklin County, Roanoke County, Giles County, Craig County, counties in West Virginia that have pulled together and created a group called POWER, Preserve Our Water, Heritage, and Rights. You can find it at POWHR.org. And we really are in the kind of part of this fight with them. So check us out, check out our Facebook pages, check out our websites, and do what you can to help us fight this pipeline from coming through and ruining our beautiful environment.
What's your Facebook
page? I'm Preserve Montgomery County, Virginia, and the coalition group is called POWER, Preserve Our Water, Heritage, and Rights. It's POWHR.org.
Thank you so much. Yes, sir.
Real quick, just Josh and his Progressive VA website, he has a spreadsheet that's on that Facebook page that lists a number of committees and things that you can find out more information where they meet and things of that nature. If anybody's going to create an extra tab on that for organizations, so if you want to get on that list, I think that would be a good thing to do.
Yeah.
So the people here who might, heard something they want to know about, they can find out.
This is a Google Doc that's open.
Great. Thank you. Jordan?
My name is
Jordan. Old friend?
I worked for Sam during his first campaign, I believe.
When I was young.
I'm currently unaffiliated. I just moved back to Virginia from Nashville. I will be starting a cop watch group, and I already said something about this. I just want to stress how important it is if, as a white person, you're driving down the street and you see a police interaction, get out of your car and get out your camera. It really, really makes a difference. Like, I've watched in Richmond for years, and I have tons of stories. If you have questions, I will tell you about it. So along with the cop watching, if you are cop watching, there are 2 really helpful apps. One is Cell 411. Everyone should get that. Connect with your friends. Cell 411. It makes it so that you can send alerts to your friends if you're being assaulted, if the police show up and you don't want the police there, if you just need extra people around. You can send a public alert so that cop watchers can see it and come be with you, or so that your friends can see it if you want a private alert. The other one is the ACLU Justice Virginia app, I think is what it's called. If you're cop watching, you can take a video. It sends the video directly to ACLU. The police cannot delete it. So please, 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 if you see a police interaction as white people, this is something
it's
super
VA Justice.
Easy. VA Justice, the ACLU app. It's super, super easy, and it does make a difference. So please, if you don't want to be a part of the organization, if you just want to do it while you're walking down the street and you see something cool, if not, please contact me. I want to make a team for this. I want to make sure people are supported. Additionally, I'm a grassroots radical socialist activist. I'm down for locking myself to shit.
And she believes in roller derby.
Please contact me if you're organizing direct action civil disobedience. I am down for
Thank you, Jordan. Thank you, Jordan. Thanks right here. Yes, ma'am.
My other lives, I'm a certified yoga instructor. I normally get paid, but then for the month of December, what we have left to November, if we can connect, I am certified in PTSD, trauma-sensitive yoga. And for those of us who are still stuck in mourning or can't get beyond the grieving process or want to reconnect with our strength, if you can get me a room and we can connect at the time, I'll be happy to work with small groups.
I'll get you a room. Just let me know. Thank you so much for sharing. Right here, 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 and there.
Okay. My name's Raphael. Hi, everybody. There were some flyers at the front. We started a
student organization at Virginia Western Community College. Initially, it was kind of preparing for maybe pushing back against the apathy of if Clinton became president and some of the issues that were raised by Donald Trump to continue to say that's not acceptable, even if some people felt a little more safe. Now that he has become the president-elect, I kind of feel like we might want to try to bring some of these voices into Virginia Western and some of the people from Virginia Western out into the community to try to connect on all of the great things that you're talking about. On the flyer, we're meeting Tuesday.
What's the name again?
Our Global Community.
Our Global Community.
There's a Facebook page, and we're trying to meet Tuesdays at 6. The exact location isn't set. We're going to work with some other groups and see where we can. There was a sign-up sheet. We got some emails. If you want, you can get with me afterwards, and we can see what we want to do.
Thank you so much. I appreciate that. Jim?
Yep, there's a local organization called Blue Ridge Coalition Against Gun Violence. It is a local coalition of several groups. The primary thing we do every year, Sam gets to see us every year. We come during MLK Lobby Day to put pressure on the state legislature to pass sensible gun laws. We're not against the Second Amendment. We're just in favor of sensible gun laws.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Jim and Mary. Mm-hmm. Ben, I have one right there.
Ben Bristol. I'm with Plowshare, the oldest peace group in the state of Virginia. And so we do things to, you know, resist war. So we have the Silent Peace Vigil that goes on every month. It's been going on for, I don't know, 20 years, 30 years or something. We also work on other issues like death penalty, because they're going to bring executions back starting early next year in Virginia. I think they're like 5 in a row that are going to happen quickly or something. So that's another thing you can get involved in if you want. And we do other things like we distribute media around the area, you know, alternative media, newspapers like Appalachian Voice and Virginia Defender out of Richmond. That's a social justice paper. So we distribute them all around the area to, you know, provide an alternative to the corporate media. So check us out at website plowshareva.org or check out our Facebook page, see what's going on.
Thank you, Ben. Contact Ben for Plowshare. Yes, sir.
Some Harrisonburg resources that might be useful to you all. In particular, newreadjuster.com, newreadjuster.com, which focuses on democratizing knowledge of how to balance the economy, not the budget, which helps us understand the federal policy space so that we can envision possibilities and raise our aspirations. Basically, a big part of Bernie's playbook, trying to make it available to everybody.
Thank you so much. Well, I think that about does it. We want to thank all of you and thank the organizations as well for coming. Some of you traveling very far for 4 hours. As far as I'm concerned, tonight we were here to empower you, and that's really my role moving forward. As politicians, we've got enough power, but if you can think of innovative ways for us to be able to empower you, I hope you'll see that as my role in moving forward. Please be involved with some of these organizations, and if there are ways we can help you in the future, please let us know. Thank you so much for coming, and please travel safe as you...
Before you...
Yep.
We do have one of the 100 Fearless Men that just started
there's
in Roanoke.
Another organization called 100 Fearless Men. There's a guy named Sean who we can put you in touch with if you're wanting to work on violence prevention. They've got a curriculum and they've got a group. You can just get in touch with me. I'm happy to put you in touch with Sean. Thank you all so much for coming.